research in historical yoga, modern yoga, and the current global yoga phenomenon has become an important academic field. The beginning of modern yoga is often considered to be 1896 with the publication of Vivekananda's book Raja Yoga. The current global yoga phenomenon refers to the global success of yoga and the dominance of asana or body yoga. The United Nations proclamation of an International Yoga Day in 2014, to be celebrated annually on June 21, the commercialization of yoga becoming a global multi-billion dollar industry, and yoga becoming part of the programs offered in commercial gyms and removed from Indian spirituality and ideas of renunciations, exemplifies the current global phenomenon. Findings from academic historical research on yoga have provided important knowledge about the roots and developments of historical and modern yoga and the current global yoga phenomenon. They have furnished important correctives to assumptions made by modern and new traditions of yoga, as well as by previous research on yoga. Modern yoga was the result of great creativity by persons who utilized the circulation of ideas between India and the West for innovative purposes. The result was the expansion of a great variety of traditions of yoga. A main topic of yoga studies has been the transition from pre-modern to modern yoga. In this lecture, I look at a small revival of Sāṃkhyayoga, also called Pātañjalayoga, orthodoxy in Bengal in the late 19th century, that was part of the transition from pre-modern to modern yoga. I will focus especially on the founder of this revival of Sāṃkhyayoga orthodoxy, Hariharānanda Āraṇya, a Bengali renunciant and yogi who lived from 1869 to 1947. I will use Hariharānanda Āraṇya as an example of modern religious revivals in India based on new interest in ancient Sanskrit texts in a 19th century India and the circulation of ideas between India and the West. There are many other examples, and some still unrecognized as products of new interest in Sanskrit texts in a 19th century India and the circulation of ideas between India and the West, but promoted as traditional with a mystical unknowable origin. This mystical origin is often referred to as oral traditions, and by the faithful believed to have been unchanged for many hundreds or even thousands of years. Such claims of oral traditions function similar to claims of revelations, as attempting often successfully to give a transcendent foundation to traditions created and maintained by humans, and to protect these traditions from scrutiny and critical examination. In yoga traditions, the guru is often assigned authority based on his access to such postulated oral traditions, claimed to go back to yogis in caves in the Himalayas and encounters in such caves. And modern yoga teachings are promoted by devotees as ancient since they go back to such oral traditions preserved in the Himalaya. Hariharānanda is not one of the famous and popular figures of modern yoga. Although the English translation of one of his books written in Bengali is much admired and used, The Yoga Philosophy of Patanjali. English translation published originally by University of Calcutta in 1963, but reprinted in the United States by Suny Press in 1984, which brought it wider attention. Even though absence of popularity means that he is not one of the mega gurus of modern yoga, he is nevertheless an interesting case. His case illustrates the revival of the Yoga Sutra, the foundation text of the philosophical system called yoga or Sāṃkhyayoga and its teachings. He practiced the teachings of the Yoga Sutra. That is, he combined excellent knowledge of Sanskrit and the Sāṃkhyayoga philosophical tradition with sannyasin and yoga practice. A critical approach is necessary for understanding the history of yoga and modern revivals of ancient Hindu traditions. There are several other examples of modern manifestations of ancient Hindu tradition that can be understood as similar cases to the one I touch on in this lecture. The term modern yoga refers to traditions and transformations of yoga related to a revival in India in the last decade of the 19th century and in the 20th century. Revival of old yoga traditions and creation of new ones resulted from a new interest in yoga and caused a worldwide dispersion. Especially modern asana or posture practice or body yoga included a great variety of elements and was influenced by the global circulation of ideas and practices related to sports, traditions of gymnastics, bodybuilding, ballet, and traditions related to physical well-being. And it was primarily some of these modern forms of posture yoga that spread worldwide. By the late 20th century, posture yoga had attained an immense success and had become a global phenomenon. The word yoga in English and in other languages has now mostly come to be synonymous to posture yoga, asana-based yoga. The global yoga phenomenon of the 21st century is dominated by asana or posture practice, influenced by modern Western systems of physical fitness training, such as traditions of gymnastics. The global yoga phenomenon can be considered a later development of modern yoga. Another dominant feature of the current global yoga phenomenon, in addition to its emphasis on body and health, is the setting in which it is performed, in which a teacher gives instructions in body postures, asanas, to a larger group in a classroom-like situation. And the group performs body postures one after the other, often in fixed sequence. There is no precursor to this in India before the 20th century. An important source for the development of this school class-like environment in yoga asanas was Shivananda, who was based in Rishikesh in North India from 1924, after ending a career as a physician in British Malaya, later Malaysia. Shivananda had medical education, was fond of gymnastics, and worked as a doctor before he took sannyasa, that is, became a renunciant in 1924. Shivananda had several influential disciples, such as Satyananda Sarasvati, who founded the Bihar School of Yoga. The performance of body postures in fast frequency, in fixed sequence, was developed in particular by Pattabhi Joyce. The most important figure of early modern yoga in terms of global influence was most probably Vivekananda and his text Raja Yoga, published in 1896. Raja Yoga was a commentary and interpretation of the Yoga Sutra. Vivekananda traveled to North America and Europe on lecture tours. He presented a lecture on which the introduction chapters in Raja Yoga are based to an American audience in winter 1895-1896. And his instructions and interpretations were shaped by his wish to be understood by an American audience, a number of whom had background from theosophy, mesmerism, transcendentalism, and new thought. The ideas of these religious movements dominate Vivekananda's interpretation. Vivekananda's commentary on Yoga Sutra is therefore non-traditional. Both his examples and his interpretations were adapted to and influenced by the knowledge and interests of his American audience. Vivekananda's American audience sat inactively, listening and on chairs, which contrast with the asana yoga classes of the global yoga phenomenon. The most important figures for the development of the global asana yoga, that is modern postural yoga or yoga gymnastics, were yoga gurus active a few decades later than Vivekananda, such as Yogendra, who lived from 1897 to 1989, Kuvalyananda, 1883 to 1966, the already mentioned Shivananda from 1887 to 1963, Krishnamacharya, 1888 to 1989, B.K.S. Iyengar, 1918 to 2014, Pattabhi Joyce, 1915 to 2009, and others, who blended Indian and Western traditions of sports with teaching of posture and meditation yoga. I will focus on the revival in Bengal of an orthodox Sāṃkhyayoga interpretation of the text, the Yoga Sutra and its commentary, Vyasa Bhasha, together called Pātañjalayoga Shastra, and the establishment of a Sāṃkhyayoga monastic tradition based on that textual tradition, the only one in modern India. Pātañjalayoga Shastra, probably authored by the same person around 350 to 400 of the Common Era, was a tradition of Sankhya philosophy, and it blended Buddhist philosophy of meditation with Sankhya philosophy to give Hinduism a philosophy of meditation. Asana in the Yoga Sutra means just sitting comfortably. Yoga Sutra is a text on yoga as meditation, not body postures. Mark Singleton has suggested that Orientalist interest in the Yoga Sutra rescued this text from obscurity, and that it was Orientalist scholarship who created the false impression that Patanjali's Yoga Sutra had enjoyed hegemony throughout the course of yoga's development. This false impression about Patanjali's Yoga Sutra has been a dominant idea in modern yoga. The new interest in Yoga Sutra was a product of the circulation of ideas between East and West. The yoga philosophy associated with the Patanjali Yoga Shastra came during the 19th century gradually to be given more attention because of the interest in the text by the Orientalists, its association with philosophy, and the interest of theosophists. This text was also unpolluted by association with low-caste yogis and was seen as the yoga text of proper yoga, a new upper-class and upper-caste yoga. It was able to make yoga upper caste and upper class. Yoga attained by this a higher status. By some, this yoga was promoted as the pinnacle of Indian culture, most famously by Vivekananda. For him, the diversity of Hindu religion exemplified different yogas, so yoga was also seen as able to unify this diversity. This religious diversity was then contrasted to the colonial West. Hinduism was spirituality, the West was materialism, and yoga understood that spirituality was India's gift to the world, and the Yoga Sutra emerged as one of the central texts in this Hindu revival. A text that had received little attention before the middle of the 19th century is now the second most translated Hindu text globally after the Bhagavad Gita.